On December 23, 1909, the USS Utah was launched and work began to make the ship ready for duty. On August 31, 1911, the ship was commissioned and the second new Florida-class battleship was ready. The Utah weighed almost 22,000 tons and had a top speed of 20 knots. A crew of 1,000 worked the ship. With her 5 gun turrets and 2 torpedo tubes, the Utah showed America's naval power. The Utah served for 20 years as part of the Atlantic Fleet. In 1931, the Utah was reclassed and started its new mission as an experimental mobile target ship. Using state-of-the-art remote control, the Utah could duplicate battle conditions, allowing for attacks from air and sea. To prevent damage, 6x12 wooden timbers were placed on the deck to protect against aerial practice bombs. Armed with some of the best anti-aircraft weapons in existence, the Utah continued functioning as a target ship and gunnery school until the attack on December 7, 1941.
They didn't have air conditioning on those old ships. I came up topside to go in, lay down on a cot, get a little sleep. I wasn't on duty. I was off duty. Well, somehow or another, the chief signalman was up there with me, too. And we were talking and driving a cup of coffee, and I took my white pants off, was standing there in my skivvies, and all at once, we saw these planes, and the chief signalman, I handed him binoculars. He says, "Give me the binoculars." He recognized them right away, but we had no more than recognized them. Yeah, we got 2 torpedoes, aerial torpedoes, on the port side.
I was sitting 2 decks down reading a Sunday newspaper that I had bought the day before in Honolulu, an early version of the Sunday newspaper. And when the first torpedo hit us, I didn't know it was a torpedo. All I knew is that something hit us, and someone hollered, "Japanese air raid, honest to God." And I started to get up. Now I got knocked flat on my face and busted a bunch of teeth. And about that time, the second torpedo hit.
I had just went down to the switchboard to relieve the man on duty. His name was Joe Barta. And he says, "Boy," he says, "I want to hurry up to the top. I want to get a Sunday paper." So he had my friend Roy Sunlighter was dogging down the hatch. It was all to be painted. So he says, "Nobody can go up and walk in the wet paint." The torpedo hit and water come in. So I started pulling the power off. Joe Barta had to cross the amplidine room and go up on the other side. Well, about the time he got there, the battle grading came down and he never got out. He's still aboard. Ship started to turn over and I had my flashlight in the hand. I got right by the hatch to the amplidine room, and pretty soon the ship had rolled over. Water come in and hit the batteries for the emergency lighting and made a little explosion.
And I had to go up a ladder and aft, and up another ladder, and aft. I was 2 decks down to get up to the top side of the ship. And when I got up to the top side of the ship, I saw 2 things. I saw a big puff of black smoke to my left, and I saw a Japanese plane circling over with his left wing down, and he was close enough, I could actually see him. And I decided this is no place to be. I'm going to go over the side of the ship. And I did. I went over the inboard side of the ship, jumped off into the water.
But fortunately, I got down on the bridge, and I had to practically crawl up to the starboard side because she's lifted to port. Just as I got to the gunwale, call it, the lines gave way. I ran over the side, up over the bottom. I got the only injury of the war. I slipped and skinned my behind on the barnacles. We hit the water and it was full of fuel oil. The only thing you could see was the whites of our eyes. But while we were swimming to the beach, they strafed us and got several guys. And there was a big sewer ditch being dug about that time. About 12 feet deep, we all hit that because the planes were still strafing.
Swam over to a 26-foot motor whale boat, and I climbed in, and there had been some guys who had gone hand over the lines to get over to the quay. And I said, is there someone up there that can run this boat? And a guy named Leonard, we called him Gus, Leonard Horn came down and he got the motor boat started. We started picking up men. And believe it or not, the first man we brought out of the water was a guy who had gone to school with me, Donald Austin Green. So he became my bow hook. I would go up to some men and he'd pull them out of the water. And we pulled some more men out of the water.
I went up to the bottom. And there was the hatch. And the wrench that was supposed to have been there was there. And four great big hinged bolts held it down. So I loosened them and opened it up. And I thought I was in a snowstorm. There was asbestos pouring over me. So I crawled down in there. And I kept the wrench with me and it kept tapping on the bottom, until I could hear a hollow sound, and pretty soon I thought I did. And anyway, after a while, this Stanley Szymanski, he heard it, and he says, well, he says, we got somebody on there. So he went to the Tangier to see if he couldn't get a torch and stuff to burn a hole. And I guess they had a new OD there, and they refused him. So he says, well, there's the Raleigh on the other side. He says, they're in pretty bad shape, but we'll ask them anyway. So he went over and he talked to the Warren carpenter, Ray Talene, and Ray Talene says, sure, what do you need? And I'll send a crew to help you. That's the difference in people. So they came over and they just got started and I heard rat-tat-tat-tat-tat. And I thought, well, the pneumatic chisel, I had no way of knowing. And they were being strafed, so they got under the bilge keel. Then they came back and they tried to talk, but it's awful hard to hear through 1 inch of metal. So I know that they were there, and pretty soon I saw a little red flame, and it kept going out. So anyway, the air pressure in there kept putting the torch out. So then they finally got the hole cut, and they had one fellow up there with a bucket of water to tip it over and cool the metal, and he never got a chance to tip it over because I was out.
Carl Johnson, Aubrey Mahaney, and John Vassen continued to serve in the Navy for the rest of World War II. These men are just some of the American heroes from December 7, 1941. Salvage efforts began in 1942 and continued until 1944. In 1956, further efforts to remove the Utah were rekindled by the 14th Naval District. These plans were discontinued when the Chief of Naval Operations brought to light that the Utah is the resting place for 58 sailors and should not be disturbed.
Early in 1970, talk began by shipmates and supporters of the USS Utah that a memorial should be built to honor the dead. 58 sailors and officers gave their lives on December 7, 1941, when the Utah was attacked. On May 27, 1972, Senator Moss of Utah dedicated the memorial. The Utah and her crew were an instrumental part of the struggle in the Pacific. The training that the Utah had provided to the pilots, warships, subs, and anti-aircraft gunners made the Pacific Fleet a well-trained force early on in World War II. The Utah's advanced remote control systems provided training of combat situations and was a key part in preparing the Pacific Fleet for war. The memorial is a 40 by 15 foot concrete platform connected to the northwest shore of Ford Island by a 70 foot walkway. The site of the memorial is a beautiful and tranquil resting place. A naval color guard continues to raise the flag each morning at the memorial to honor the sailors that are entombed. Due to military restrictions on Ford Island, few have the opportunity to visit the USS Utah Memorial. The memorial truly is a place to honor and pay respect to the men of the USS Utah.
The USS Utah as she sits on the harbor floor. Swimming along the starboard side, you see portholes. Twisted and wrecked metal covers areas of the ship. One of the Utah guns covered with sea growth. A ladder that once led to the deck. A porthole left open 60 years ago, now the interior is full of silt. Bubbles escape from the hull. After 60 years, the ship still leaks oil. Salvage cables still drape over the hull of the USS Utah.
The The USS Arizona was launched on June 19, 1915, with the christening of Arizona Water and Champagne from the New York Navy Shipyard. She was commissioned on October 17, 1916, and cost the United States Navy an estimated $16 million. America's newest and most powerful battleship was now part of the Atlantic Fleet. In 1921, the USS Arizona became part of America's Pacific Fleet. The USS Arizona continued to serve in the Pacific Fleet until December 7, 1941.
Claire Hetrick. I was on the USS Arizona December 7, 1941. Early morning, I was mess cook and finished the mess cook duties. I had liberty that day, so I went to the forward head and was getting ready to shower and shave and go to town, do what most sailors do. And at about half shaved, and all of a sudden, all hell broke loose. Guns firing, big guns, and you don't fire guns in the harbor. So I run out, looked out to see what's going on, and the first thing I seen was an airplane with a big red meatball on it. And right then and there, I knew what was going on.
On the morning of December 7th, we just finished breakfast. And I picked up a few oranges to put in my white hat to carry down to the sick bay to a buddy of mine that was just went to sick bay the day before. He had a little touch of yellow jaundice or something. As I was wandering out of the casemates there, number two casemate, I heard some sailors yelling and pointing toward Ford Island, and went up to see what all the commotion was all about, and the planes were bombing Ford Island. And
without any delay, I went to my battle station, which was aft on the third deck. I was a hoist operator, and got the hoist set up, ready to transfer ammunition. And in the magazine, one deck below, they asked for help, so I went down. And to this day, I think that's what saved me, because I was below the armored deck.
But anyhow, we kind of identified the planes as Japanese, and they sure weren't friendly. We knew that for sure. And I started for my battle station, which was a sight setter in a port anti-aircraft area for the port anti-aircraft gun. So it was up on what they called sky control platform, which was one deck above the bridge where the captain and the admiral were both killed. So my duties there was setting sights for the anti-aircraft guns on the port side. I had a bird's eye view of the harbor and all the planes coming in over the mountains, and I could see the torpedoes coming in at the Oklahoma and West Virginia, and I swore there was a couple of tracks that were headed right for the Arizona. But anyway, we were firing up all of our ammunition. We had ready box ammunition behind every gun. And we were firing at the dive bombers, and we were firing at some high altitude bombers over us. But we could see that the fuses on our projectiles weren't reaching them, because they were bursting way short of the high altitude bombers. And the dive bombers were going by, and of course the torpedo bombers came in from toward like over at sub base and IEL landing toward Battleship Row, and when they peeled off, it could just look like you could put your, from my vantage point up high there, I could reach out and touch them. We could see the pilots, everything. So it was pretty close encounter. Our ensign was in charge of the director. There was 10 men to man that director, so we were trying to get some more ammo, and he said, "I'll go see what the holdup is," and he went out the hatch and never did see him again. But and the fire controlman was alongside me there. He jumped out. Where the ship was hit, it was something that just shook the whole ship like a dog would shake a rat, I guess, but just a vibration and a thunderous impact. And then the big explosion, and it just engulfed us in a big ball of flame that I guess the plane went about 400 or 500 feet in the air, which involved the whole stack area, or I mean the foremast area, and blowed 120 foot of the bow of the ship off. And of course I reached out to close that hatch, and that's where I got pretty well burned up. And we're just cowering and behind some metal and in the director there, and waiting for the fire to cease or something to happen, because there was no place to go unless you jumped right into the flame. So,
and we got about five rounds of 5-inch ammunition in the hoist, and there was one heck of an explosion and knocked us all on our cans. And we started smelling smoke in the magazine, and somebody says, let's get out of here. After the explosion and everything was dark. We had no power whatsoever. We had no battle lamps, no nothing. It was just pitch dark. You couldn't see anything. If you didn't know your way around, you wouldn't have made it. So I started out and right straight up through the, there was a ladder and stairways going right straight up just outside the magazine. And as we went out the first hatch, somebody was blocking the way. He had no idea who it was. And I told him, get the H out of there. And he said, I can't make it. And so I just pushed him on out, not knowing that he was hurt. He didn't say he had trouble or anything. He just couldn't make it. So then went on over to the starboard side, and the water was about 12 inches from running over the quarter deck at that time. And being a non-swimmer, I never passed a swimming test when I went through boot camp. But I think I was the fastest swimmer there that day.
It was just a ball of flame, and you were inside the ball of flame, and it was just any place that you couldn't get out of the way. You move around here a little bit trying to get behind some of the machinery or some of the sight setting equipment or the panel there or something, but all at once it just kind of died down, and the wind had a little breeze there and blew the smoke away, and we jumped out of the director, and if it hadn't just died down, I wouldn't be here. But I could look down on the deck and I could see a lot of my sailor friends running aft, trying to get aft out of the fire and the clothes on fire and whatever, and it was one hell of a scene. And if the good Lord has anything to say about what I do in the hereafter, I hope it isn't being burned up. We couldn't get off there, so we were. As you know, the Vestal was tied up alongside the Arizona at that time as a repair ship. And she was her bow to our stern. And there was a sailor on board there. Last name was George, I think. And he threw us a line, a heaving line, and we pulled across the heavier line and tied it off on the Arizona. And we crawled hand over hand across that line, probably 45 foot in the air, and probably about 75 foot across the line, hand over hand. And that was after we were burnt. And of course, how bad was you burnt? They say, well, we just pulled the skin off our arms and threw it down. It was in our way when we were trying to go across the line. And we got across the line and got on board the vessel, and we were there for a few minutes, quite a few minutes, I guess. And they got us on a shore boat and got us out in the middle of the harbor going to the beach, and we could see the bombers moving in again and coming down. They dropped some bombs that were dropped in the middle of the harbor there. And
both Claire Hetrick and Donald Stratton survived the destruction of their ship, the USS Arizona. Claire went on to serve in the Navy throughout World War II. After suffering burns to over 60% of his body, most third degree, Donald was discharged from the Navy. After extensive rehabilitation, Donald reenlisted in the Navy and served during World War II. The removal of remains and the attempted salvage of the USS Arizona began just a few days after the attack.
I was having breakfast in the wardroom of the Argonne, and an officer came in and asked if there was an officer from the Arizona there. And I raised my hand. He says, after breakfast, you go down to the dock. There'll be a motor whale boat, 20 men, and some sheets and pillowcases. And you go over there and take all the bodies off above the waterline. So I said, yes, I'll do that. And that's what we did. We got on board the ship after it cooled down a little and took all these bodies and wrapped them up in sheets, and what we couldn't get in the sheet, we would put in the pillowcases, and at the last of it, we'd take all the odd arms and legs and torsos and things like that, put them in pillowcases, and then they were taken ashore and identified and buried. And then we even had a dustpan and a broom where we would sweep up all the little odd pieces of bones that we could find. It was a real gruesome job. Some of the fellows just couldn't do it. As a matter of fact, we had to go way up on the bridge and get a couple of three bodies off of there and had to lower them down with ropes.
That's when I went to the Arizona salvage group. But we had a 50-foot motor launch, 40-foot, and a whaleboat. They took the 40-foot away from us. So in the 50-foot, we had a deep-sea diving gear. You know, the big pump, takes four guys to operate. And we had all the hose, the deep-sea suit, the helmet, the lead shoes, the whole bit. And we knew the ship. We'd been on long enough that we knew where, what. But they wanted the secret confidential stuff.
Salvage efforts on the Arizona continued until the end of World War II. The Navy had stopped all efforts of recovery due to the fact that it became too dangerous to go further into the ship. For the next few years, the Arizona was mostly forgotten. In March 1950, a flagpole was erected and a small wooden platform was built to aid small boats coming to the Arizona. In 1957, Congressman John Burns introduced a bill for the building of a memorial. The bill passed on March 15, 1958. Building began in 1960, and the memorial was dedicated Memorial Day 1962. Since then, it has been visited by millions.
Well, I think part of the fascination of visiting the USS Arizona Memorial is the history behind the Pearl Harbor attack. Many of our visitors are really unaware of that history. They know that this is a so-called tourist attraction. And one of the things that we try to do is really take them out of that mode and make them understand that it really isn't a tourist attraction, but rather a place of death and remembrance and sacrifice. And it truly is a place where the world comes to remember and America still comes to mourn. The USS Arizona Memorial was constructed in 1960-61 and dedicated on Memorial Day 1962. The memorial itself spans the wreck of the Arizona and doesn't touch it. It's really suspended above it by 36 piers. The memorial is made of materials of steel, girder, and concrete. It was designed by Mr. Alfred Price, a local architect here, who believed that the memorial should be a place of reflection and somberness and silence. His architecture reflects that. The memorial itself has been placed really in three categories. As you walk up the stairs going in the memorial, the first place you go into is the entry room. On either side of you are the flags of our country. In particular, on the left side are the flags of all the armed services here in Hawaii at the time of December 7th, 1941, in the national colors. On the right-hand side are the flags of the states of all the battleships here, including the auxiliary gunnery ship, former battleship Utah. As you continue out of that room, you go into the main assembly area. There are wayside exhibits on either end that describe the ship and its state today, In other words, you get to see the ship as she was in 1941 and as she is today as an archaeological site. Oil leaks up from the sides of the ship, and you can literally peer off either side of the opening windows and look down on the ship itself. On the right-hand side of the memorial, you'd be looking at barbette number 3, in which gun turret 3 sat on top of. Occasionally, you can see portions of the ship sticking out of the water, depending on the tide. And that is looking towards the aft section of the vessel, where gun turrets 3 and 4 were. On the left-hand side, as you look over, you will see the galley area of the ship going up towards the bow. There's portions of the smokestack ring that can be seen. You can see actually the ovens that were made up part of the galley. So the most visible portion of the ship is right off of that right-hand side. You can see the fairleads and bits that secured the ship to the mooring quays, there are two mooring quays that are on either side of the memorial in which the USS Arizona was tied to on the morning of December 7th. And lastly, when you go into the final room, is the shrine room, in which a wall of marble, Vermont marble, confronts you with all of the names of the Arizona dead, 1,177 names of sailors, officers, and Marines that lost their life. They represent the greatest loss of life of Navy personnel in their history. So it is a special place.
The USS Arizona, as she is today. A large blast hole on the stern end of the ship. As you can see, wiring harnesses are visible just inside the entrance. As we swim over the ship, debris still litters its deck. Oil from the ship. Oil on the ceiling of an interior compartment. An open hatch allows you to view deep inside the ship. Turret number 1 with 14-inch guns. The Arizona had 4 sets of 3 14-inch guns. 9 of the guns were salvaged from the ship. After 60 years, oil still seeps from the ship. teakwood deck is now covered with silt. Interior compartment of the ship. A hatch used by sailors over 60 years ago, the ship still sits on the harbor floor. Leaving the USS Arizona 60 years after the attack.
The National Park Service USS Arizona Memorial Visitor Center. The Visitor Center was opened in 1980 and has had millions of visitors from all over the world. The Visitor Center is the starting point for visitors wanting to make the trip out to the USS Arizona Memorial. The Visitor Center Museum has many artifacts from the USS Arizona and from the attack on December 7, 1941. The museum is an open-air museum, and future plans are to expand and develop more exhibits to increase the number of artifacts on display. Models show you how the ships looked before and after the attack. The museum also has many Japanese artifacts. Exterior displays line the walkways around the visitor center, memorials to all that were involved in the attack.
Many men and women were involved on December 7, 1941. This was a day that changed history and the American people forever. We cannot forget about what happened or the people that were involved. They truly are American heroes. 60 years have passed, but the USS Utah and the USS Arizona remain in the harbor, a part of history. The USS Utah, the USS Arizona, revisited.